Our faith that Jesus is alive, and because he lives, we live. I was singing this song yesterday, because he lives, and it's an old song, but the words were such a revelation to me, and I thought, do we really live like this? Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, every fear is gone. Because I know that he holds my future. Life is worth living just because he lives. Those words are so powerful. And we're going to sing them this morning. Thank you, Jesus. And I just thank you for your presence, Lord. You are the most important one in this room. You are the most important one in this room. So I thank you that you have a say and you have preeminence in all things. We thank you for your presence and your glory, Lord. We thank you for your presence, Lord. We thank you for your presence, Lord. We fall upon the presence of the Lord today. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you.
Thank you.
Of the Lord today. Do not fear, do not be dismayed and discouraged, for I'm with you. I will help you. I will uphold you, strengthen you, the righteousness of my right hand. Our Father is here. Our Father is here. just take a moment and tell him you love him. Jesus, we love you. Oh, how we love you, we love you, we love you. Oh, how we love you, we love you, we love you. Jesus, we love you, we love you, we love you. Oh, you're beautiful. Glorify Jesus. Jesus, we love you. Before Pastor Tim comes, we have one more song. Jesus, your presence is just everything. Father, the person of your being, who you are, is just everything. And we cast our crowns and we cast everything we are before the Son today. And our hearts are filled with joy and victory over what you have done for us. We have not one problem in our life that you have no answer for. Every answer is found in your presence. Every answer is found in your presence. Every answer is found in your presence. We thank you for it today in the name of Jesus.
Christ was crucified. I'm sure there was a time of sadness. There was a time of sorrow at that point. But the blessing came 3 days later.
Yes.
When they found that empty grave.
Hallelujah.
And that's what this song talks about, is about seeing an empty grave.
Jubilation, that stone's been
It's all reversed, the apple, the curse, 3 days in the ground. Christ our Lord is risen, and death could not hold him down. It's not an empty grave. I hear the heavens waving, angels in jubilation. That stone's been rolled away. I feel the darkness breaking. I felt the devil shaking. Somebody celebrate. I've seen an empty
see an empty grave. Hallelujah. Oh, God, you're amazing. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. That was good. That was good. I see an empty grave. Amen. Glory. Hallelujah. 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 Good to see everybody. Today, thank God, celebrating resurrection. Amen. Hallelujah. We got missions checks. We're going to declare provision of God over. Thank you. Amen. Thank you, Father. I want to thank Pastor Rob and everybody last week. I didn't get to, the computer decided to update all of a sudden, a forced update by Windows 10. And Damon was trying to get all that done. And then after it updated, it totally changed all of the settings on our live feed system. And so they wasn't able to do the live feed last week. And I was sitting there waiting for it to come on, and all of a sudden I see technical difficulty, and it's like, I don't like technology. When it works, it's great. When it doesn't, there's just nothing. It's just gone. But thank God for the word that went forth last Sunday. We're going to be looking into the Word of God today. See that Jesus, it was all covered. He did it all. Amen. In ways that we don't even understand. Praise God. I'm not going to read these off. Just pray with me over these mission checks. Father, we thank you, God, for the opportunity, Lord God, to work in different parts of the world. Thank you for provision. Lord, I thank you that you've never, Lord, we've not had to worry. Lord, even when there was nothing in the bank account, Lord, when it was time to take care of our missions commitment, you've always met it. And Father, we thank you today that you are blessing with provision. And Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to work in different places, different parts, with different people. And Lord, we send these out by faith today and thank you, Lord, that God, you're going to multiply the seed and the bread for food. And we give you praise for that today in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Do you hold in your hand the symbols of the body and the blood of Jesus? What an amazing. Make sure everybody gets some. Last time we had communion, a whole section got left out. We don't want to do that anymore. Everybody. Amen. Some people come up to me and said, hey, what do you have to do to get communion? I said, oh man, we didn't tell you. That's a $250 a month commitment. I apologize to him. It was just an oversight. But thank God for could we just get lay on the floor and worship today? Oh my goodness. Presence of God. Amen. Thank God for the bread that Jesus broke and blessed. Lift the bread before the Lord today. Father, we thank you for this. We thank you for the bread that represents your body, the sacrifice you made for us, Lord God, the legal tender, an earthly vessel that gave you legal right to be the sacrifice. Father, we thank you for that, and I thank you, God, that through your body, Lord, you are dispersing everything you are. Lord, we remember today. We come back together as the body, as the members of Christ. And thank you for that, Father. Lord, we just bless this bread today. In Jesus' name, receive the bread. God for his sacrifice, the blood of Jesus. The bloodline comes from the Father. Therefore, we know that God paid the price for us. We have, through the Spirit of adoption, we can now cry, Abba, Father, because of what Jesus did. And Lord, we thank you, God, for this little cup that represents the fact that you shed what nobody else, you gave what nobody else could give. The most precious thing that we have. And Father, I thank you, Lord, for this cup. And I ask today, Lord God, as we take this, as we receive this, Father, Lord, we're saying we're all in with you. We're all in with you. In Jesus' name. Father, we just bless this today and ask you to bless it. Receive the cup this morning. Wow. Oh, God is amazing. We are going to be looking today at the pronouncements of the Holy Spirit through people. And God, there were so many things that we didn't understand that needed to take place. Prophecies that needed to be fulfilled. Legal right that needed to be established. And before I left a couple of weeks ago, we looked at the legal right of God, that Jesus had legal right in heaven, and then he had legal right on the earth. And I'm not going to re-preach that. That was 2 weeks ago. We did get that on live feed, so go watch it. But we understand today that through the spirit of adoption, we have been brought into the family of God. And Jesus established that, and it came through the fact that Joseph adopted him into the bloodline of his family, which went all the way back to Adam, all the way back to God, which gave him the legal genealogy on the earth to represent man and to be the legal sacrifice for our sins. And turn with me, I'm going to be reading in the book of Colossians chapter 1. Got a lot of scripture today. Going to be looking at Colossians chapter 1, verses 15 through 18. Praise God. Isn't his presence just amazing? Amen. Wow. I'm coming back from 2 weeks of what was supposed to be vacation. Ended up being an encounter and a fight that lasted for days and days and days. But an encounter with God and fighting through some things that God's been speaking to me and understanding and trying to break into. I told Sister Val, she said, "How'd it go?" I said, "Well, I come home limping." Like Jacob. Hey, you don't always walk away from these things without being affected. And thank God for the things that he's shown us. But we are fighting right now. We are fighting through the darkness and the veil that is withholding from us the most clear and under perception and understanding of what God did for us. We don't understand all of it. If we did, when I got back, I don't even remember who I was talking to, but I told somebody, I said, "Man, we have been cheated because we don't understand where we stand, who we are, and what God did, and we are not experiencing what God envisioned for us to experience as the body of Christ." Amen. We look too much to the hand of man and not enough to the provision of God. In verse 15, it says, "He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For by him all things were created that are in heaven and that are on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created through him and for him." Praise God. "And he is before all things. And in him, all things consist. And he is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he may have the preeminence." I want you to, I have in the last days, I have studied through the book of Colossians twice because I knew there was things that God was trying to speak to us. And in all of that, there's one word that just kept sticking out to me and I just kept hanging up on, and that is that he may have preeminence. Now, the word preeminence means superiority. In the Passion Translation, it says, he is the most exalted one, holding first place in everything. He does not have a second place ribbon in anything. Holding first place in everything, the Amplified Bible says, so that he alone in everything and in every respect might occupy the chief place. He was the firstborn from the dead, that he might occupy the chief place. Everybody say occupy. We, as a body of Christ, we act like renters, not owners. We act like we might not be able to pay the rent this week, and maybe we might not be receiving from God, and maybe we will, and we might get evicted. But God wants us to start looking at who we are as owners. Because there was a title deed that was purchased and transferred. And our name is on it. I'm going to try to get through this. You just got to be coming from where I just came from. But he is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. I want you to go with a little ride with me here. We're going to go through some word. In the book of Luke, turn with me to the book of Luke chapter 1 and verse 30. The angel said to her, do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bring forth a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. Hallelujah. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. And he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. Amen. Do you believe what the word declares? Yes. Praise God. Just said of his kingdom there will be no end. Oh my goodness, I could preach an hour message on every bit of this, every statement. Of his kingdom, there will be no end. I don't know what these pompous little puppets think they're doing, that they're going to reign over Jesus and run over him somehow. I got to tell you something. He sits on the throne. He sits over all things. He has preeminence over all things. Every knee shall bow. Every tongue will confess. And Jesus Christ is Lord, and of his kingdom there will be no end. Hallelujah. Praise God. Luke chapter 1. At the conception, he was declared. He was announced. Luke chapter 1, verse 41. In the womb. And it happened when Elizabeth heard the greeting of Mary that the babe leaped in her womb. And Elizabeth, being filled with the Holy Spirit, You don't understand what I just said. Under the law, that's just not right. But something's changing. There's some change coming. We might have been bound under the law, but all of a sudden some change is starting to take place. Holy Spirit has showed up on the earth, and he's starting to work in some people in some different ways, and things are getting out of hand. Elizabeth, filled with the Holy Spirit. Then she spoke out with a loud voice and said, "Blessed are you among women. And blessed is the fruit of your womb. But why is this granted to me, that the mother of my Lord should come to me?" He was declared at conception. He was announced in the womb. Turn with me to the book of Luke, chapter 13, or chapter 2, verses 13 and 14. "And suddenly, there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, 'Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men.'" See, heaven couldn't hold it back. See, he was announced at conception. He was announced in the womb. And at his birth, all of heaven got stirred up. And all of a sudden, they ripped the veil of heaven back and appeared in earth and began to declare, "He is Lord." Amen. Glory to God in the highest. And on earth, peace, goodwill toward men. See, they didn't appear to the kings. They appeared to shepherds. So now we have the lowest announcing the kingdom of God. And then the Magi showed up. And now we have the rich people announcing the kingdom of God at his birth. There are declarations taking place in every part, in every people. They are representing every aspect of life. The Holy Spirit came and began to handpick people from every aspect of life to declare the Son of God. Why? Because every tribe, tongue, every aspect, every gender, everybody needed to declare him. Luke 2, verse 22. "Behold, there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. And this man was just and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel. And the Holy Spirit was upon him. And it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. So he came by the Spirit into the temple. And when the parents brought the child Jesus to do for him according to the custom of the law, he took him up in his arms and blessed God and said, 'Lord, now you're letting your servant depart in peace according to your word, for my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared before the face of all peoples, a light to bring revelation to the Gentiles and the glory of your people Israel.'" See, I tapped Brother Tom because he is my Wikipedia. And I'm always grabbing him before church and asking him questions that he says, "Well, if I had time." I'm kind of a last-minute person. But I was asking because somewhere I remember reading that the high priest, Caiaphas, was not legal to be the high priest. And I couldn't find that. And I'm not going to say that just absolute, but I remember reading that, that somehow he was illegitimate and it wasn't lawful for him to actually be the high priest. God did not recognize Caiaphas. The Holy Spirit did not recognize Caiaphas. But there needed to be a priest of God in the temple that would declare, this is him. So the Holy Spirit come upon a devout man that had been praying and seeking God and had heard the voice of God say, you're not going to die until you see my Christ. And all of a sudden, the Holy Spirit came upon him and he ventured into the temple where there wasn't anybody in the temple that had the right to declare him. But Simeon, come into the temple, took the place of the priest of God by the Holy Spirit and said, now I can depart in peace because my eyes have seen your salvation. Hallelujah. I got to tell you something. When God can't find somebody worthy underneath all the priestly phylacteries and pompous piety, he'll go out and find somebody that's been praying and seeking his face that he can talk to, and he'll bring that person in and make them declare the word of heaven, because God will not be shut out by man. God will intervene in through the most unlikely people. Those that most think are unqualified that look like they should be king, that look like they should be qualified, but God's got a little boy out in the wilderness with the sheep that's been talking to him, that's been writing songs, that's been hearing the word of the Lord. And he says, no, I don't want any of these. I've got somebody out here that loves me. I've got somebody out here that's listening to me. Bring him in. And all of a sudden, Simeon comes into the temple in a very unholy situation. So you got to understand, Caiaphas was reigning over a fake priesthood because the Ark of the Covenant was not in the Holy of Holies in that temple. Matter of fact, when the Romans came in and destroyed the temple, like Jesus said, when they tore it down, they barged into the Holy of Holies and they said, what's the big deal? There's nothing here. Fakes and frauds, going through the motions, acting like the presence of God was there when God wasn't anywhere to be seen. And all of a sudden one day, oh, I'm getting ahead of myself, but one day all of a sudden God said, I'm not going to let this fraudulent thing go on any longer. When Jesus cried, it is finished, God grabbed that veil and ripped it open and said, see, I'm not in there. I am coming to be in you. Now, we didn't stop there. Holy Spirit's messing things up. He's breaking the rules. he's jumping over lines. And next thing you know, there's a woman by the name of Hannah who was not legally qualified to minister in the temple. But she prayed and with fastings and prayer day and night and wouldn't leave the temple. And that was all right, but she wasn't allowed to minister in the temple. But all of a sudden, the Holy Spirit came upon her, and she went and found the Christ child, and she began to declare him to be the Son of God. And God got the one. She took a person from the fall that didn't have legal right in the temple, and brought her in and said, now I want you to declare the Son of God as redemption. Oh, you're just not getting what I'm talking about. Am I sounding raspy? You got to understand. See, the curse played a heavy toll on woman. The law put a lot of restrictions on women and the presence of God because of the fall. But all of a sudden, an angel showed up and said, Mary, highly favored by God. Blessed. He couldn't even go into the temple and say that with the priests and all their phylacteries and all of them lengthening the hem of the robe. See, the hem of the robe is what represented holiness. And so the priests got in his competition, and they kept adding just a little more length on the hem of their garment than the other guy had. And they was competing with the hem of their garment, and they was trying to add on to it, not realizing that the hem of God's garment was walking among them. And one day a woman pressed through the crowd and got a hold of the real hymn of holiness and raised up, healed, and completely whole. I promised myself I wasn't going to explode today. I just left my office a while ago and I said, now son, just sit back in this thing and just give it. But how can you just sit back in something when it's a fire burning inside of you that you can't put out? So at his circumcision, Simeon stood in the temple and declared him to be the Christ. Anna came in and said, let's just read this. In verse 38, and coming in that instant, she gave thanks to the Lord and spoke of him to all those who looked for the redemption of Israel. Can you imagine Anna come in and begin to say, I mean, right there in the midst of all of that procedure and pomp and man's glory, and all of a sudden this little prayer warrior, filled with the Holy Spirit, that most people probably ignored or thought she was crazy because she was always in the temple praying. And all of a sudden, this little prayer warrior comes forward and says, look, all you that are looking for redemption, here he is. You just saw him. Oh, hallelujah. John chapter 1, verse 29. The next day, John saw Jesus coming toward him and said, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. See, John was the actual spiritual authority in that day. He was chosen by God, born of Elizabeth, filled with the Holy Spirit from his mother's womb. Matter of fact, he felt when Mary made the declaration to Elizabeth, the babe leaped in her womb. John felt the presence of God when he was still in the womb. He heard the word of God and he rejoiced in the womb. Not even able to speak yet, not even able to understand words. And yet, hearing the word of Mary about what had happened, John leaped. And here he is preaching the word, fighting with the Pharisees, calling them serpents and snakes and adders. I ain't never preached that hard. Some people say I'm pretty blunt, but I ain't never preached that hard. He looked at him and said, "Who has warned you?" I mean, with disdain. And they sought to destroy him. And here John sees Jesus. See, they knew each other. They were cousins. Ain't no sibling rivalry here, because they understood who they were. They had the word of God, and John was the authority, the spiritual authority of that day, not the high priest, John. He was the spiritual authority. So Jesus came, even though he was the Son of God, Jesus came to the spiritual authority established by God and said, "I humble myself to God's authority." And John said, "Oh no, you got to baptize me." And Jesus said, "No, let's keep this in order. Let's do this right." And so John baptized Jesus, but before he did that, he looked up and he said, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world." Let's go to Luke chapter 2. Oh, I'm getting away from myself. Verse 34. I'm trying to sit back in this thing. It ain't going to work. Verse 34 says, "And I have seen and testified that this is the Son of God." The declaration. See, you got to understand, God didn't just come and surprise everybody. Holy Spirit is systematically going through every office and every position in the earth, making them or having them to declare Jesus to be legal. Because the spirit realm is very legal. The devil is very legal. He will try every avenue to try to take you down, and he'll do it if you don't understand who you are and where you stand. There was one morning that I had been battling for like 4 days, not sleeping, and I would be up all hours of the night, just in warfare, a spiritual warfare over the provisions of God and over what God promised. This started before I ever left, because God spoke some things to me that went off in my heart, and I began to declare them, and the devil came and said, "No, you don't. You're not going to go there. You can't have it. You don't have right." But I went to the word of God, and we began to fight it out. And one morning, I was sitting there, and all of a sudden, I began to say, "I know
who I am. I know who Jesus is. I know the price he paid for me. I know that I'm born of the Son of God. I've been birthed in the Spirit, and I have a birthright from the throne of God, and it's signed in the blood of Jesus. I know who I am. And you lying, worthless failure, you are not going to back me down. Because I know who's backing me up. Oh! Whoa! You mess with me, I'm just going to sit down. Because the Lord of glory is looking at you with eyes of contempt. It says, what are you doing messing with my kid? And I'm just going to get out of the way and let daddy take care of you. My daddy can whip you. When I got through with those declarations and just establishing, all of a sudden I felt the heavens start to clear and the presence of God. Why? Because we got to know what's been done, and we got to know that we have legal right to the things of God. We're not renters. We're not trespassers. I'm not looking for a little cabin in the corner of glory land. When I walk into heaven, the angels are going to sing because I am a born again, blood washed, spirit filled child of the Most High God. And he said, you will sit with me in my throne. I'm not going to be sitting off in the corner somewhere because I have a seat right in the throne of God. It's not fair, it's not right, but it's legal and it's qualified. I didn't do anything to earn it. I don't deserve it. But Jesus paid the price so that I can be a child of God, so I can sit in the throne of heaven with him. Turn with me to the book of Luke, chapter 3. Verse 21. This is when all the people were baptized. It came to pass that Jesus also was baptized. And while he prayed, the heavens were opened. And the Holy Spirit descended in bodily form like a dove upon him. And a voice came from heaven which said, you are my beloved Son. In you I am well pleased. There's a declaration from heaven. Hallelujah. Oh, God couldn't hold it back anymore. He couldn't hold it back anymore. He said, oh, I'm so proud of you. I just got to announce that you're my beloved Son. And I am in you, I am well pleased. Oh, now the devil heard that declaration. And so he started challenging Jesus, because Jesus, after he was filled with the Spirit, he was driven into the wilderness. And, you know, I just want to say to a lot of these fakey faith Christians that feel like you never have to battle anything, I'm just going to tell you, sometimes Holy Spirit, you're going to drive you out in the wilderness. It's not going to be all cushion comforts and accolades. There's times you got to have a come to Jesus meeting, and he's going to drive you out in the wilderness, and you're going to fight it out. Amen. If we're afraid of that, we're never going to be able to serve God. Now, that didn't cost you a thing. That was just free. That's just a side note. Amen. Sister Carolyn has side notes. And that was a side note. Sometimes you got to stand up and say, let the fight come, but I'm going to trust the Lord. I got my faith in somebody that's bigger than me. And he's going to carry me through this thing. Amen. Oh, Jesus. Now the devil, in Luke chapter 4, verse 3, and the devil said to him, if you are the Son of God, if all that's true, if that voice that came from heaven, if all that is really true, if, that's what the devil will use on you every time. If you go before God and the devil will say, well, if you were better, God would answer your prayers. Well, if you prayed more, God would answer. If you fasted more, if. And at that time, you need to just stand up and say, there's no if about the blood of Jesus that covers my life. No ifs. I'm bona fide. The devil said, if you are the Son of God, and turn this bread in stone. He said, if you are the Son of God. Now listen, this is important. If you are the Son of God, taking him up in verse 5, then the devil taking him up on a high mountain showed him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. And the devil said to him, all this authority I will give you and their glory, for this has been delivered to me, and I give it to whomever I wish. Therefore, if you will worship before me, all will be yours. Of course, Jesus said, get behind me, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only will you serve. And then on over in chapter 4 and verse 34, I want you to read some. See, the devil just said, if you are the Son of God. In verse 34, Jesus walked into the temple, and in the synagogue, there was a man that had demons in him, and the demon cried out with a loud voice in verse 34 saying, let us alone. I've had that happen. Let us alone. What have we to do with you, Jesus of Nazareth? Did you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God. Now we've even got the devil announcing. He showed up. He's on the earth. It's real. It's true. The Holy One of God is here. And Jesus said, shut up and come out of him. That's all the conversation we need to have with him. Amen. We don't need to have any more conversations. You are the Holy One of God. I'm so proud of myself. I have stuck with my notes all the way through here. Matthew chapter 17. Turn with me to the book of Matthew chapter 17. I'm giving the guys on the cameras a break today because they're not having to do this. Matthew 17, verse 2 through 5. And he was transfigured before them. His face shone like the sun, and his clothes became as white as the light. And behold, Moses and Elijah appeared to them, talking with him. Then Peter answered and said, Jesus, said to Jesus, Lord, it is good for us to be here. Oh, yeah, boy, you feel that way, don't you? If you wish, let us make here three tabernacles, one for John, one for James, one for... Let us make three tabernacles, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. While he was still speaking, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and suddenly a voice came out of the cloud saying, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased, hear him. Now, I want to declare to you, after all the declarations that have taken place, Jesus went up on the Mount of Transfiguration. He went up there, and suddenly he was transfigured. This was a coronation of heaven, declaring Jesus to be ready, to be legal, to represent humanity and God. And here on the Mount of Transfiguration, all of a sudden, he changes into that glorified body. And the glory began to shine out of him. And God said, this is my Son, in whom I am well pleased. They had a meeting with Elijah and Moses and God, and there was a meeting that took place, and it was a coronation. It was a declaration from heaven saying, okay, we're ready to initiate this thing. It's about to happen. Something's about to change. What used to be normal isn't going to be normal anymore. Jesus was just a really exciting prophet and healer, going from town to town, healing people. Everybody was excited about that, and that was wonderful. But he's about to change from the exciting miracle worker to the redeemer of all mankind. And he went up and met with God, and God said, it is time. You are ready. You are legal. We have legal right to proceed. They came down off the mountain. In Matthew 21, we call it the triumphal entry. They had a coronation from heaven on the Mount of Transfiguration. See, Jesus come to reconcile that which is in heaven and that which is on earth. He's operating in two theaters, operating in two positions. As I preached a couple of weeks ago, the Son of God and the Son of Man. And here they have a coronation on the Mount of Transfiguration where everything is considered to be right and ready. And then Jesus starts riding into town on this donkey. And here the Holy Spirit starts messing things up again, and the Pharisees thought they had it all done because the lamb, the spotless lamb, the procession of the lamb had just come through that gate where they bring the Lamb of God to the temple to be examined before the offering. Jesus watched that lamb, that procession, as the lamb is taken through that gate, and then he hops up on the back of that donkey and starts down the same road, following that lamb right through the gate. And as he goes through the gate, Holy Spirit starts prompting people and poking them and saying, it's time, it's time, it's time. And all of a sudden, they begin to grab branches, and they begin to take off their outer cloaks, lay them on the ground, and a proclamation began to come from earth. They didn't even know what they were doing. God had just proclaimed, it's time. You're ready. We have legal right to proceed. Jesus comes down through the gate following that lamb, and all of a sudden the people begin to cry out, Hosanna, Hosanna. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Earth begin to cry out, he's ready. It's time. We have legal right to proceed. The Pharisees got upset and said, calm these people down. Don't you see what's happening? Don't you hear what they're saying? That's when Jesus said, oh, you got to understand, earth has to proclaim me at this moment. And if these people don't proclaim me, all of creation, including the rocks, are going to start crying out, because I have come, I am ready, it is legal to proceed. The proclamations and declarations just kept coming. And now they proclaim him to be Hosanna. And Jesus follows that lamb right into the temple. The spotless lamb. Now, when Jesus arrived in the temple, it wasn't quite the celebration everybody was wanting, because he came in with a whip. Because there was a bunch of money changers in there buying and selling offerings and ripping people off. See, what they would do is people would bring their offering to be inspected, and they would say, nope, that's not qualified, but we just happen to have some for sale right here that's already been qualified by the priest. You have been pre-qualified for this card. We're going to charge you a whole lot of interest. I knew I was going to knock this cup off of here. We're going to charge you a whole lot of interest on this offering, but you got to do it or God's not going to hear you. And the Son of God and the Holy Spirit just happened to walk in on that mess. And next thing you know, he makes a whip and starts kicking over tables, undignified, Pentecostal, fit, and started driving people out of the temple. You say, that's the wrong direction. They're supposed to be coming in the temple. No. Jesus said, my house will be called a house of prayer. You've turned it into a den of thieves, and I'm running the thieves out. I kind of have a feeling. I'm not prophesying this, but I kind of have a feeling that the Holy Spirit, should I even say this? I have the feeling the Holy Spirit has been braiding a whip for the last couple of years. And he's about to start whooping some folks, because he's tired of the den of thieves that has taken over his people. Now, don't shout me down now. Because his house will be called a house of prayer. In other words, it'll be focused on God, not man. Amen. So Jesus went into the temple. Man, I have got this done by 11:35. We're on the final stretch. Is that not a miracle? We are in amazing... This is a miracles are happening right now. I have went through 2 pages of notes, and it's only 11:35. That is amazing. I just want, y'all ought to have goosebumps on you right now, because that was a miracle. We're on the final stretch. Now, I didn't say I was closing. I said we're on the final stretch. We haven't even got to the good part yet. So Jesus, while the priests were examining the lamb that was brought in for the sacrifice, they were also examining Jesus because Jesus kept hanging around the temple and they kept asking him questions, and the lawyers and the Pharisees kept trying to trip him up and trick him. What were they doing? They were checking him to make sure that he was the spotless Lamb of God. Just like the lamb that was offered. Now, things are about to get a little dicey here. In Matthew 26 and 60, after they arrest Jesus, he had to raise them up so they could arrest him. You know, I think I'd have just walked off. If I was a big soldier and I went to arrest somebody and all he said is, "That's me," and I fell down and couldn't get up, I think I'd just, when I got up, I think I'd have just walked off. It's like, you know, I don't think I'm big enough to do this. But for some reason, they went ahead with it because he gave them permission. And so here they've arrested Jesus and brought him in before the high priest, and Jesus had nothing to say to the high priest because he didn't even recognize him. He was illegal. He refused to even recognize him. So in Matthew 26 and 60, they look for witnesses, but it just simply says, but found none. They were looking for somebody that could come up with an accusation against Jesus that they could make stick and prove that he was not legal, that he was not spotless, that there was flaws in him, but they could find none. The only thing they could find was somebody finally told the truth and said, "Well, we heard him say that he could tear this temple down and raise it back up in 3 days." And the high priest jumped up and tore his clothes. I mean, it's terrible when you're so hungry to find something wrong with somebody that somebody finally tells the truth and makes a good statement, and you say, "That's it," and you carry. I don't know what they made clothes out of back then, but them high priests, they ripped their clothes all the time. I don't know what's wrong with them. They was forever ripping their clothes. They'd grab the neck of their clothes and rip them. I mean, that must have been some cheap material, because I can't do that. And they'd rip their clothes. Imagine. I can't even imagine. Somebody jump up and start ripping her clothes. It's like somebody call the people with the little white jackets. These guys have lost it. But they finally found an accusation. They said, "That's it, it's blasphemy. He's worthy of death." And so they start sending him, they send him to Herod. Herod's all excited because he thought he's going to see a show. This is the miracle worker, you know? And so Herod's all excited that Jesus is coming, and Jesus gets there and he won't talk. Why? Because Herod was illegal as well. And Jesus simply did not recognize his authority. So he had nothing to say to them. And so finally, he's sent to Pilate. In the book of Luke, chapter 23, we see Jesus being brought before Pilate. And you say, why did Pilate have to get involved? Besides the fact that there was legalities that had to do with the Roman Empire, Jesus had to be proclaimed by every authority of that day to be legal. We've went through several of them. And now he comes before Pilate because in that day, Rome was the authority of the world. They reigned as the authority, the kingdom of authority. You see, you know where I'm going here, don't you? Jesus didn't come and say, I don't care what you think, I'm going to do this. No, he had to have legal pronouncement. And so they take him to Pilate, and Pilate talks to Jesus. Let's just read it. I'm not going to paraphrase it. Let's just read it. Verse 14. And said to them, you have brought this man to me as one who misleads the people. And indeed, having examined him in your presence, I have found no fault in this man concerning those things which you accuse him of. Oh, you got to understand. Listen to me. The most powerful kingdom in the world, that which represented the authority of man, Jesus is standing before him, and this kingdom, you got to remember, the devil took him up on a high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms, and he said, all this authority is mine. It's been delivered to me, and if you'll fall down and worship me, I'll give you all of this authority. So the most powerful authority of man in that day is standing before Jesus, Pilate representing the Roman Empire and representing Jerusalem is standing before Jesus under the auspices of the emperor ruling over them, which is Satan, and he is ruling over the Roman Empire. He has power over the Roman Empire. He has given power to the Roman Empire. And now Jesus is standing before the Roman Empire, who is ruled by Satan, and the kingdom of man ruled by Satan declares, I can't find any fault. He is legal. If anybody ever felt like they was losing control, the devil was about to have a nervous breakdown at that moment, because even the kingdoms he ruled over was declaring Jesus to be legal. Pilate comes out, tells the people, says, I don't know what's wrong with y'all. There's no fault in his mind. What are you wanting to kill him for? He has no fault. And Herod with him. Herod found no fault with him. And they became buddies after this. And Herod and Pilate could find no fault. But they were under the authority of Satan. How could this be? The prince of accusation, the prince of lies, is ruling over these people, and they're standing before Jesus, and they can't come up with a lie. They can't come up with an accusation. I find no fault in him. And Pilate said, who you want? And you know the story. They ended up, you know, choosing Barabbas. Boy, it takes a lot of discipline sometimes to be a public speaker. Hey, can't go there. Said, give us Barabbas.
Pilate released Barabbas, washed his hands, and said, I wash my hands of this mess. This is wrong. I wash my hands of take him and do what you will. He went to the cross instead of Barabbas. And he went, and the Bible says, the Old Testament, the law says, cursed is any man that hangs on a tree. And so Jesus went to the cross in a cursed position. Hung between two thieves. Declared to be unholy. Declared to be unrighteous. Declared to be cursed. Dying on a tree, being crucified as a common thief. And yet, every authority on earth except the Pharisees had declared him holy, legal, the Son of God. And yet he went to the cross. As I said before, if Satan would have just understood what he was doing, the Bible says that they would not have crucified him. Because the devil, in all of his ego, finally thought that he was winning. Finally thought that he, because Jesus didn't give up his hand in the Garden of Gethsemane, took on the sins of the world, he drank the cup of bitterness, and Satan didn't know what happened. It was shrouded. And when Jesus emerged from the garden, he held the sins and iniquities of all of creation and carried it to the cross. Satan, not understanding what he was doing, was going to crucify all of his power, all of his tools, all of his iniquity. The devil was about to put his own end on the cross. Colossians chapter 2. Let's go back to the book of Colossians. I've been there for days. Colossians chapter 2, verse 15. It says, he is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. We read this. For by him all things were created that are in heaven and that are on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things, and in him all things consist. I want you to jump over to chapter 2 and verse 14. Having wiped out the handwriting of requirements that was against us, which is contrary to us, he has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross. What did we just read? Jesus took the legal right of accusation that Satan had against us, and he nailed it to the cross and shed his blood to make it legal. And all of the power of hell to hold you bound was nailed to the cross and broken, and Jesus declared you legally free. Come on. See, it wasn't the Son of God that got crucified. It was his body. But it was the power and the legal right of Lucifer to accuse us and to hold us captive that got nailed to the cross and crucified.
Oh, had he known what he was doing. When that blood began to run down that tree, when it began to flow out of the body of Jesus, he was seeing the doom of his own power and of his reign, and didn't even know it. Until all of a sudden Jesus, who ascended, before he ascended, he descended into the earth. And he led captivity captive. See, 1 Peter, I believe it is, tells us that Jesus even went and preached to those before the flood. See, all of a sudden, the devil thought he had put an end to the Son of God. But suddenly, he winds up, walks into hell, and begins to preach, I have paid the legal price for you. Your debt is paid in full. Your sins are forgiven. Get in line. We're leaving here. Come on, somebody. It says he led captivity captive. And he ascended. Now, Satan is the principality of the air, the ruler and principality of the air. How many know that? See, all of a sudden, Jesus and all those people that Satan thought that he had conquered suddenly start rising and going right through the principality of the air's domain. And all of a sudden, Jesus stopped. He said, oh, I forgot something. We have a parade. I forgot, we're going to have a parade. See, in that day in Rome, all the people understood this when it was written, because in that day in Rome, when a king was conquered, they would bring him back to Rome and they would lead him through the streets of Rome, showing that he had been conquered and he was now under the authority of Rome. Oh, come on. It says, and he disarmed principalities. Verse 15, having disarmed principalities and powers, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it. Oh, come on. Jesus stopped and he said, hey, you remember on the mountain when you said, see all these kingdoms? They have been delivered to me. And if you'll bow down and worship me, I'll give you all of this. You remember when you said that? Kneel. Because now I have all authority in heaven and in earth, and I am preeminent. I am superior. And he led him on a procession in front of all the angels and demons. Led him on a procession. Now, this is out of 3 Timothy, but I think he had a chain around his neck leading him. Leading him around, saying, this is he who would rule. This is the one who had all authority and was going to give it to me if I would bow down before him. He no longer has authority. I now have all authority. Yeah.
We are not living under an oppressive government because we are the children of God. We are not living under the rule of Lucifer or the principalities of the second heaven because we have a Savior who has become preeminent, superior over all things. And in the book of Hebrews, I'm closing, it's not 12 yet. In the book of Hebrews, In the book of Hebrews, it said that he upholds all things by the word of his power. Now it also says, what is man that you are mindful of him, or the son of man that you care about him? You have made him a little lower than the angels. Now the book of Hebrews tells us that Jesus became a little lower than the angels, paid the price for us, and then ascended far above the angels and is seated at the right hand of God. So now all things are under his feet. Now the Bible says in Hebrews, he said all things have been put under his feet, talking about man, but we don't see all things put under our feet. We were given all authority, but we don't see all things being put under our feet. But then it says, but we see Jesus, because he is the head of the body. And we are the church, the body, the fullness that fills all in all. I want to declare to you today that this is not some kind of religious organization. We are not talking about some kind of pharisaical form covered with the phylacteries of man trying to represent something that doesn't exist. We're talking about a living Savior. I can't even get into the rest of this, but he is seated at the right hand of the Father, not in a spirit body, but in a transfigured human body. And he represents us before heaven. There's a lot of people that seems to have lost confidence in God because of earthly battles and political fighting. There's a lot of people that have put their confidence in the power of man. And I got to tell you something. The power of man will always fail. But we don't serve the power of man. We serve a Savior who is preeminent. And if we don't get our faith back in the preeminent Savior and start declaring him to be Lord, in spite of what man might do, then we're never going to move into what God has promised us. God's not sitting here waiting any longer for man to declare him legal. It's already happened. Nobody can declare him illegal because he is seated at the right hand of the Father, making intercession for me and for you. I am not down here by myself. I have somebody that has represented me every day of my life. And so if you stand with me today, if you would. Why would we shun such an amazing thing? Why would we ignore what God has done for us? I'm not willing to do that. I'm gonna praise his name. Oh, come on, somebody. I'm gonna praise his name. I'm gonna declare his name in the earth, because Jesus came and reconciled that which is in heaven and that which is in earth unto himself. And today we stand in Christ. We don't stand in ourselves, we stand in Christ. And standing in Christ gives us legal right to be a son and daughter of Almighty God. I don't know about you, but I'm not willing to be cheated out of my birthright anymore. Holy Spirit asked me the craziest question before I left on vacation, and this is what started the war. If I'd have known what was going to happen, I think I'd have just stayed here and fought it out and then went on vacation. But he asked me a question when he was talking to me about all this stuff, talking to me about legal right, talking to me about the fact that Jesus had legal right on the earth and legal right in heaven. In both places, he represented both. Talking to him about birthright. And all of a sudden, Holy Spirit asked me a question that just stopped me. Because I've served the Lord and preached for 40-some years. He said, when are you going to pick up your birthright? What birthright? I realize I'm a child of God. I realize that I'm in the kingdom of God, but that's my birthright. I said, all my life I've served under the birthright of my family, because on my dad's side and on my mom's side, both, they were builders, they were creators. They built. And I've done that my whole life. So that's my birthright, isn't it? Then he spoke to me. And he said, you were birthed into a powerful move of God. And it's time you stop being disconnected from that and go pick up your birthright. You say, well, that's easy. But when I went to try to pick up my birthright, I ran into an army that was trying to hold me back. Why? Because we as the children of God, when we finally get a hold of who we really are and who God is in us and what he's done for us, things will change. Things will change. I want to just ask you the same question. I don't know what your life is. I don't know where you're at in life, but I want to ask you the same question. Are you going to pick up your birthright? You might have to go with me and fight with God for a little while and leave limping, humbled. But it's worth it. Are we going to pick up our birthright? We have a birthright. We have anointings and mantles and positions in God that are vacant because the people of God are not picking up their birthright. It's time to pick it up. And if you're not saved today, if you're not born again, if you haven't given your life to Jesus, you haven't even started. It's time for you to accept your place in the family of God. It's time for you to say, yes, I want to be a child of the Most High God. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you, Father, for, Lord, your word going forth. I thank you for salvation right now. I thank you, Father God, for redeeming power. Thank you, Father, for redeeming power. I'm going to ask you a question. If you can say with me, God, I'm ready. I'm ready to pick up my birthright. I want you to come and join me up here. If you're not saved, come with them. If you haven't been born again, come with them. Just let's all come. You say, I'm ready to pick up my birthright. I'm ready. Jesus made it legal for me to be a child of the Most High God. And I'm going to accept that. I'm going to accept. Come on, move forward. I don't bite. I'm done spitting. Come on. Move forward. Hallelujah. I am ready to humble myself before God and say, God, sign me up. Sign me up. Amen. I came home from this trip so humbled before the presence of God and realizing what humbled me is realizing what God really wanted to do for us, what God really had in store for us, what God really planned for us, and just wanting to say, God, here I am. I don't deserve this, but I'm qualified through the blood of Jesus. Lift your hands today. Just lift your hands before God. And say, here I am. I accept the birthright of the kingdom of God. I receive all the rights and privileges of this birthright. I will walk in the authority of my birthright that I have received from Jesus, because I sit with him in his throne. I am seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Therefore, I am a legal heir of the inheritance of the kingdom of God, and I receive my inheritance in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now all heaven heard you say that. Devils heard you say that. And you got to know who you are in order to say, I know who I am. I know who my Lord is. And you're not going to steal from me what is rightfully mine. This birthright belongs to me. It is mine through the blood of Jesus. Father, I thank you for the power and the glory. Thank you for the power and the glory of your Spirit, Father. Hallelujah. Oh, let's just take some time and worship the Lord. Declare, just make your declarations right now who you are. Just begin to declare it. Hallelujah. Begin to declare it. Say, angels, take notice of this day.
that I have received my birthright. And you are ministering spirit sent forth to minister for those who are heirs of salvation. Thank you. I receive you into my life. I receive you into my life. Angels, come on. Let's do this thing. Let's do this thing. Let's live this thing. Hallelujah. Oh, we give you praise today, Father. Glory and honor to your name, Jesus. Glory to your name, Father. Oh, you are worthy. You are worthy. You are worthy, Lord. You are worthy.
Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is life.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. We speak to all that which belongs to the kingdom of this world. Shame, reproach, sickness, disease, and infirmity. We speak to you and say, we no longer belong to you. My body no longer belongs to you. My mind no longer belongs to you. My mind and my body and my spirit belong to God. And now I declare all of your stuff illegal in my body and in my mind and in my spirit. You are illegal. Hallelujah. Glory. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Father, everything that you've given us, we claim it. Our inheritance in our children, we claim it now. They are heirs of the kingdom of God. Those that are outside of the kingdom, we call them back. We call them in. Come home. Come in. Come in. Come into the birthright in Jesus' name. Come into the birthright in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father. We give you praise today, Father. Lord, I declare that the outpouring of the Holy Spirit belongs to the body of Christ. We are not trespassers. We are not renters. It belongs to us because we are the children of God. Now, Lord, we just receive what belongs to us, Lord God. We receive the outpouring of the Holy Spirit in this land, in our lives, in our homes, in our churches. We receive the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. We are not squatters trying to get something from the kingdom of God. We are rightful heirs sitting at the table, and we are going to eat at the table of God. Father, we receive what belongs to us by the rightful demands of our inheritance. In Jesus' name, Satan, we declare that you are illegal. We declare that your attempts are illegal. We declare that your accusations are illegal. You have been proven to be illegal in our lives. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Jesus, thank you for representing us before the Father. The Bible says that the Holy Spirit is the guarantee of our inheritance. Now, Holy Spirit, manifest the children of God. Manifest the children of God. Raise us up. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Manifest the inheritance. Glory. Manifest the inheritance. You know, this thing is powerful. It'll get a hold of you. In my dreams the other night, when I was asleep, I didn't sleep much, but I'd fallen asleep. And in my sleep, this cry began to come up out of me. And in my sleep, I was crying out with everything in me, God, we need a move. God, we need a move. I woke up with this cry coming out of me, God, we need a move of your Spirit. The Spirit of God is crying out inside of us. He is in agreement. We got to come in agreement that God has declared it legal. He already said it in the last days. You pour out the former and the latter rain together. It is declared, it is legal, and we just got to come into the place where we are the children of God that are ready to receive it. We just might be that generation. We just might be that generation. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Lord. See, in my dream, I was on this chat parking lot. And I believe it was an open-air meeting that I was at, and I was on this chat parking lot, and me and Betty, there was an old Ford pickup sitting over here. And I remember the bumper, chrome bumper on this Ford pickup. And me and Betty fell down on that chrome bumper like an altar. And we were crying out to God, God, we need a move of your Spirit. I believe we're about to see some of the greatest demonstrations of the presence of God that this country and this world has ever seen. Hallelujah. Father, we say yes. We say yes, Lord. We say yes, Lord. Oh, God. Holy God. Lord, you have been declared, and today we declare you King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We declare you the King, the ruling magistrate, the superior one over this world, over this nation, over this state, this county, over this church. In every church. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Father. Yeah.
Glory. Glory. I wish I could lay hands on you today and impart to you what I have experienced. But I can't do that because it's got to be you. It's got to be you and God. And you have made a declaration today that is going to draw you into an encounter. Amen. You have made a declaration that's going to draw you into an encounter. Don't fight the encounter. Fight for it. Fight for it. There'll be times, at the most inopportune times, the Spirit of God's going to confront you, and you're going to have to come before God at that moment. You're going to have to just humble yourself. You might find yourself sitting in your car weeping because the presence of God has confronted you. But let it happen. Don't fight it. Fight for it. Fight for it. Father, thank you. Thank you for changing everything. Thank you for changing everything. Hallelujah. Glory. Just lay your hand on somebody's shoulder next to you and say, God, God, bring us in. Bring them in, Lord. Bring them in, Lord. Father, we give you praise, strength. Bring them in, Lord. Bring them in, Father. Hallelujah. Manifest the kingdom of God. Manifest the kingdom of God. Bring us in, Father. Bring us in, Father. In the name of Jesus, bring us in, Father. Glory. Bring us in, Father. Glory. Hallelujah.